today. Thank you for this Lord's Day that we can gather to worship. Thank you for the opportunity to praise you together, to hear your word preached, and to celebrate communion together. Lord, I pray that you would bless our time now. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so let me start off with a little trivia question. And maybe it seems a little easy, but it's kind of a little bit of a trick question. What is the name of our church? Ah, very good. So I expected you to say Grace Community Church, and of course that's the name that we go by. But yes, as a legal entity, our name is Grace Community Baptist Church Incorporated, if we're going to be really technical. But I'll give you credit for that. So we are Baptists. So let me follow that up with another question. What is distinctive about being a Baptist? When someone says that I'm a Baptist, what does that mean as opposed to being some other
denomination of Christianity?
What are the distinctives of being Baptist? What's that? Bible teaching, many of them are, some of them are not. But that's not something specific necessarily to being Baptist. Adult baptism, yes. Believer's baptism is pretty distinctive to being Baptist. Not exclusively, but the idea that someone must make a profession of faith in Christ in order to be baptized, as opposed to in many other denominations or traditions, infants are baptized rather than, and certainly adults would be if they're converts. But the way that most people are baptized is as an infant. That's not the case with Baptists. They only baptize those who profess Christ. Anything else that is distinctive or characteristic of Baptists? Yes, that's a good point as well. In many denominations or traditions, sprinkling or pouring can be used to baptize, but for Baptists, it is generally immersion. That is, someone dunked completely under the water rather than water being poured over them or sprinkled on their head. Okay, so very good. Another distinctive of Baptists is that they believe strongly in the freedom of conscience of the individual. Okay, they acknowledge that the individual person, the individual believer, has freedom of conscience. They're free from the state, because God alone can judge the conscience, and the state therefore cannot judge the heretic or the atheist. And as we move forward and take a look at the history of Baptists today, we'll see a little bit of why that is, or why that is important to Baptists. Kind of coming out from that, the freedom of the conscience of the individual, comes another characteristic that's common among Baptists, not exclusive to Baptists, but very common among Baptists, and that is congregational autonomy, or the individual congregation governing itself under the authority of Scripture. So in many denominations, many traditions, there is a hierarchy of church government, where an individual congregation is subject to, in many cases, a long sort of chain hierarchy of higher bodies. But as is the case with our congregation, we govern ourselves under the authority of Scripture. So this congregation selects its pastor, it selects its leaders, and those leaders, along with the congregation, govern the affairs of the church. So that is, again, not exclusive to Baptists, but is characteristic of Baptist churches, and comes out of that importance placed upon the freedom of the conscience, where the individual believer and the individual church has a lot of leeway to make decisions in regards to many things. So, as over the past number of weeks, we've been looking at church history, and we're getting close to the sort of modern day, the current era. And today we're going to be focusing on the history of Baptists in particular. Now, there's some disagreement about how we would trace the history of Baptists, so we'll take a look at a couple of those different tracks. And we're also going to be looking at the world missions movement briefly, something that's not exclusive to Baptists, certainly, but it is something in which Baptists have played a significant role. So as I mentioned, there's a number of points that have been identified as the point of origin for Baptists. And the probably earliest one is going back to the Anabaptists. So last week we were talking about events in the mid-1800s. To look at the history of the Anabaptists, we go back to the 1500s, about 300 years prior. And so if we can together remember back a few weeks before that, we were talking about the Reformation. The Anabaptists arose during the Reformation. Remember that date there is very close to when Martin Luther came onto the scene. And as we looked at the Reformation a few weeks ago, we talked about Martin Luther, and we talked especially about Ulrich Zwingli, and then a successor, John Calvin. So Martin Luther and Zwingli are often referred to as magisterial reformers. And they're called that because they kind of worked along with the state in many cases to reform the church. We talked about how the Lutheran Church and the Reformed Church were the state church in various parts of Europe. They are to this day in many cases. And I may have mentioned in passing, but if so, no more than mentioning in passing, what are known as the radical reformers. And the Anabaptists fall into that category of radical reformers. The Anabaptists believed that Luther and Zwingli should not be working with state authority, and instead they wanted to have complete separation from the state and from the organized church as it had existed up to that point. Now, where we might kind of identify a connection between the Anabaptists and Baptists generally is that the Anabaptists also rejected infant baptism. They baptized those adults who professed faith in Christ, and because they rejected infant baptism, they were denounced as rebaptizers. So in their society, basically, everyone had been baptized as an infant. The Anabaptists, upon the profession of faith of an adult believer, would baptize them again. And so that's where they got their name from. The Anabaptists were heavily persecuted, both by the Roman Catholic Church and by other reformers. They were seen as child abusers and heretical, seditious, and anarchical. And so many of them emigrated to the Americas to escape persecution. Anabaptists typically were pacifists, nonviolent, in some cases non-resistant. And the label of Anabaptist underneath that, we find significant diversity both in theology and in practice. But generally, again, they were very suspect of state and church authority. And we can kind of follow the descendants of the Anabaptists down to today, to some well-known groups, especially around here. The Mennonites and the Amish, who are actually an offshoot of Mennonites, are the sort of descendants of Anabaptists. And again, if we look at those sort of categories, we see a lot of diversity within them even today in terms of both theology and practice. Of course, we're very familiar with Mennonites here because not so much in Lehigh Valley, but there's a lot of Mennonite settlement both in the southeast of Pennsylvania and to the west of here in Berks and Lancaster counties. And of course, the Anabaptists were attracted to Pennsylvania because Pennsylvania was established by William Penn, a Quaker, who certainly knew about persecution himself and wanted to create somewhere that people could practice religion as they saw fit. And so that's why it was an attractive place for Anabaptists. So that's the earliest sort of point that people might look to trace the origin of Baptists as a sort of distinct group. A second place we look to is the General Baptists, who arose in 1608 in England. A key figure with the General Baptists is a man by the name of John Smith. He was a preacher in Lincoln, England, and he led a group of like-minded believers to Amsterdam to escape persecution and to establish what they saw as a pure church. John Smith and those who followed him became convinced that believers' baptism was biblical and that infant baptism was not biblical. So the first English General Baptist Church was formed in Holland under the leadership of John Smith. Interestingly, he was actually later excommunicated by his own congregation because he tried to make the church become Waterlander Mennonites. So they did not like that course, and so they pushed him out. However, one of his followers, Thomas Helwys, returned to England with some other General Baptists, and they founded the first Baptist church in England. Helwys himself was imprisoned, and he died while in jail. So, what did the General Baptists believe? Well, we've already talked about the fact that they rejected infant baptism and believed believer baptism was the biblical practice. The General Baptists are called General Baptists because they held a general view of atonement. So what does that mean? So they did not believe in the idea of limited atonement. Rather, they believed that Christ's death applies generally to all people and that all people can either freely accept or reject Christ's death, and that people can lose their salvation. So it was their belief that Christ died for sins, and that death of Christ for sins that and the forgiveness that entails is available to anyone who will basically accept it. And also that if you have accepted it, you could then lose salvation at a later point. Not too much after the General Baptists come the Particular Baptists, and they have a very similar name and a similar point of origin to the General Baptists. They also arose in England, but differ pretty significantly from the General Baptists in terms of their theology when it comes to salvation. The Particular Baptists emerged from the Puritan Separatist movement in England, and they were known as the first English Calvinistic Baptists. That was their first congregation. They put together the London Confession of 1644 to distinguish themselves from the General Baptists and also to distinguish themselves from the Anabaptists. So they recognized we have a similar name. They also believed in believers' baptism rather than infant baptism, but they saw a need to distinguish themselves from those two other groups that sound, at least in name, quite similar. So, where do the Particular Baptists differ from the General Baptists? Well, probably most significant is that which their name refers to. They believe that Christ's death has a saving significance only for those particular souls who are regenerated by the Holy Spirit. So, in other words, salvation is only effectual for those whom God has chosen, for God's elect. So very significant difference between the Particular and General Baptists. General basically said Christ died for sins. Anybody can come to God and be saved, whereas Particular Baptists, very similar to Reformed theology, essentially that, they're Calvinistic, that Christ died for sins of those whom God has chosen, and only those people will be and can be saved. So, similar names between the General and Particular Baptists. They arose, though, at a similar time, in a similar location. Different theology, but they both grew rapidly around the same time in England during the time of the English Civil War, which was in the 1640s, and then in the following Commonwealth period when England was without a king in the 1650s. So a couple of Particular Baptists to note. First of them is a man by the name of Andrew Fuller. He lived in the late 1700s and into the 1800s. He observed that amongst the Particular Baptists, some congregations had adopted something that's referred to as hyper-Calvinism. And the idea of hyper-Calvinism essentially is that since God has ordained all things, therefore man cannot be held responsible for his sin. And also, preachers have no business proclaiming the gospel to all hearers, but only to those that they have determined to be elect. So in other words, the hyper-Calvinists look at the sovereignty of God and say, because God is sovereign and has ordained all things, therefore, I'm not really responsible for what I do because God has ordained it. In addition to that, because God has chosen whom he will save, those who preach God's word should not be preaching to those who are unsaved, but only to those who the church can identify as being God's elect. So in other words, what we'd be seeing under that sort of viewpoint is that the Christian says, I'm not responsible for my sin, and therefore that certainly gives room for a lot of licentiousness because you aren't responsible for what you do. Additionally, you would see basically no evangelistic effort from the church because they're saying we not only don't have a responsibility to preach the gospel to those who aren't saved, but also that we should not be doing that. So Andrew Fuller identified that viewpoint, and he basically argued against it. He came out against that, and he affirmed God's complete sovereignty, but in doing that, he also urged Christians to resist sin and to preach the gospel to all people and let God sort out who would be saved. So rather than the church trying to identify, oh, these people are elect and those are not, we're going to preach to these people but not to those, Andrew Fuller says, no, we're going to preach the gospel to all people, and it is up to God. God knows who is elect. We do not know. So we preach the gospel to all people, and we'll let God work it out from there. And in addition to that, he would certainly have identified in Scripture where we are exhorted in many places to live in obedience to Christ, and that it is our responsibility to do that. So that's a key figure and a key argument to make. Certainly, I think you may come across some hyper-Calvinism today, and Andrew Fuller saw that all the way back in the 1700s and made some points to counter that. Another notable particular Baptist is somebody that you probably are very familiar with, and that is John Bunyan. He lived about a century or so before Fuller, and he spent a significant amount of time in prison for his beliefs, but he put that time to good use by writing. And of course, his most famous work is Pilgrim's Progress. Another notable work of his is Grace Abounding. Another later particular Baptist, somebody whose name was mentioned this morning already, and that is Charles Spurgeon. He lived in the 1800s in England, a famous preacher. At the age of just 19, he was the pastor of the largest congregation in London, and that congregation continued to grow under his preaching. He preached 3,600 sermons, authored 49 volumes of commentaries and devotions, and remains an influential figure to this day. So the Anabaptists, they arose in Germany, in Central Europe, amongst Germanic peoples. The general and particular Baptists, they arose in England. We come to the final group that we can look at, perhaps as an origin point of Baptists today, and that is the American Baptists. In very close proximity, historically, to the general and particular Baptists, but in another part of the world, in the New World, in America. So the first Baptist church in America was founded by a man named Roger Williams. He came from England to the Massachusetts Bay Colony in 1631. And if you remember from previous weeks, the Massachusetts Bay Colony, that was the Puritan outpost or colony in the New World. So he came to the Puritan colony. But there he spoke against the magistrates enforcing church attendance and enforcing other spiritual duties. And because of that, he was banished from the colony. So he traveled not too far away to what is today Rhode Island, and there he established the community of Providence. And interesting fact, up until I think just a couple of years ago, the state of Rhode Island's official name was the State of Rhode Island and Providence Plantation, because of the first settlements there founded under Roger Williams. So the Baptists kind of had a home in America, in Rhode Island. And as with other Baptists, what was important to them, or some of the things that were important to them, were religious freedom and freedom of conscience for the individual believer. Of course, they also practiced believer's baptism. And as was the case in the old world, in America, they also often faced persecution here as well. Like their forebears, perhaps, in Europe, they also rejected the notion that the church is a state entity. So they believed in an independent church. Some key American Baptist figures. Isaac Backus, early 1700s into the early 1800s. His own mother was arrested for not paying the state congregational church. And so he wrote to promote freedom of the church from the state. At that time, it was not uncommon that basically you had a tax obligation to the church as well as to the civil authorities. Another key figure, John Leland, late 1700s into the 1800s, he also argued for the disestablishment of religion with the Bill of Rights that was adopted as part of the United States Constitution. So Baptists made up a relatively small portion of the population in the American colonies, but some of what they believed to be important about the interrelation between the church and the state certainly made an impression upon the way that the U.S. government was organized. Again, they rejected the idea that the church is an aspect of the state. They believe in an independent church, independent from the state. So, sometimes when people talk about Baptists, they have the conception that with Baptists having such a prominence placed upon the provision for the conscience of the individual, that therefore there's a popular misconception that Baptists don't really articulate what they believe because everybody has a sort of freedom of conscience. But it is a misconception. There have been a number of notable confessions, a number of notable statements of faith that outline specifically what is believed by Baptists generally. So a few of those are referenced here. The First London Confession of 1644, and if you remember what we mentioned a minute or two ago, that was created by the early particular Baptists in England to differentiate themselves from the General Baptists and from the Anabaptists. The Second London Confession, about 45 years later, 1689, that's a revision of the Westminster Confession and utilizes the same language with some exceptions and distinctions for, especially in regards to baptism and congregational government. And then in the New World, the New Hampshire Confession in 1833 is most widely used among English-speaking Baptists. Now, as you probably know, here we have our own statement of faith. That's something that the leadership of the church promises to uphold. While Baptists do place importance upon freedom of conscience for the individual within congregations, it's very typical that there is a standard of belief that is held by that congregation. And of course, it has been our objective, and it would be the objective of any Christ-following church, to ensure that our statement of faith is directly in line with Scripture. So that importance of freedom of the conscience must go along with a desire and a commitment to be faithful to the Word of God. So last week, it was mentioned that during the Second Great Awakening in the Americas, there was a growth amongst the Baptist congregations and Methodist congregations. the revivals that occur sort of away from the population centers and away from the established churches created organizations that supported an increasing interest in missionary outreach. Now, again, Baptists and Methodists certainly did not begin foreign Christian missions. We've talked about a number of very early missions work throughout this course. We can even look back to Jesus himself. In the course of his ministry, he often traveled to Gentile areas, to Samaria, away from the Jews themselves. And of course, he left his apostles with the Great Commission to go and make disciples of all nations. And the last words of Christ recorded in Acts, where he commands his disciples to go and be witnesses even to the end of the earth. So from the very beginning of Christianity, there is a focus on missions, on taking the word of God outside of where it already is and to people who have not heard it, people who need to hear it. And obviously, the book of Acts, we see the apostles going out and carrying out that sort of mission. But after the time of the apostles, in antiquity, we see missionary efforts. We talked about some in the early and late Middle Ages. Remember, a few weeks ago, we talked about the Reformed churches in Switzerland under Calvin were very focused on establishing a Christian society there. They also sent pastors and missionaries abroad. That was part of their focus. A couple weeks ago, we talked about Jonathan Edwards and his missionary work in Massachusetts to Native American tribes there. So certainly, throughout the history of the church, missionary work has been something that has gone on. It has been focused. It has been a mission given to us by Christ himself an example provided by the apostles as well. However, with that said, as we think about the Baptists today, Baptists have had a significant role in the advancement of modern missions, and there's a few key figures that I'll quickly draw your attention to. One of them is a man by the name of William Carey. He lived in the 1700s into the 1800s. He was an English pastor, and he's often known as the father of the modern mission movement. Now, he worked in a shoe shop, and so as he worked at his bench on shoes, he had books next to him so that he could learn all different foreign languages so that he could be prepared to be a missionary. In 1792, along with some friends, he organized the Baptist Missionary Society. Andrew Fuller, who we mentioned previously, was a part of that as well. And the society's objective was to send preachers to remote parts of the world. William Carey himself and his family went to India. They suffered significant trials as they brought the gospel there. But he is part of translating the Bible into 42 Asian languages. And was contributed to establishing 20 churches in India. So a significant impact. Two others, Adoniram Judson and Luther Rice, roughly about the same time as William Carey. They were sent out by the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions. They started out as they were on a ship heading to their destination. They were Congregationalists. However, while en route to India, as they studied Scripture, they became convinced that believers' baptism was the biblical position rather than infant baptism. So they had kind of a life-changing experience on their way to the mission field. And when they were there, Judson experienced significant trials, especially in Burma, but he had significant impact. 7,000 Christians and 100 national preachers have been sort of attached to his work or as a consequence of his work in Asia. And then the final point here about world missions is the Triennial Convention, which again occurred for the first time around the same time as these other men worked. And this is the first national organization of Baptists in the U.S., and the primary objective was foreign missions. So another example of the importance that Baptists have placed historically on missions and taking the gospel to those who have not heard it. Any questions? we will conclude there. Next week, Randy's going to be teaching our final week in this course. So it's hard to believe that we've been at this since September, but we're going to wrap it up next week, and we'll have one more week before Christmas. Not quite sure exactly what we'll do with that week, and then in the new year, we're going to start something new. So with that, why don't we pray to close our time. Heavenly Father, thank you again for this morning and for this half hour or so that we could take a look back over some more recent history of the church, of your people. And as we have previously, as we've looked back, we thank you for your faithfulness in preserving your word and preserving your people. We thank you for sustaining your people through trials and for upholding them. Thank you for your faithfulness. Please help us to follow in the footsteps of those who have gone before us, who are faithful and have followed Christ themselves. Please help us to follow Christ.